I want you to say, Father, there is a light I need. Say it. There is a light I need for the remaining part of this year. There is a light I need to make this year unprecedentedly productive, prosperous, fruitful, profitable. Abba, I want to make progress in every aspect of my life. Say it, Abba, I want to make progress in every aspect of my life. Say, Father, the promise that you confirmed with an oath, I stand on the eternal efficacy of that promise. And I say it becomes my living experience. Abba, tell him, Abba, tell him, Abba, say Abba, or Daddy. Daddy, you are inexhaustible in all your provision. Okay, Galatians 3:16. Can you do it? You don't do it. After service today, Miracle, Joey, and Josh. Okay, just see me. I want to have lunch with you, dinner with you. Is it okay? Huh? Is that, you happy? Okay. Right. Galatians 3:16, and your aunties in the house, like Sister Rosie and Sister Sharon, you can join us. Hear this. To Abraham and his seed were the promises made. To Abraham and his seed. You've heard us talk about the promise, isn't it? Eh? We've told you that God made a promise to Abraham, and God was more abundantly willing to prove to you and I that Bible calls us heirs of the promise. Note the words. We are. That's who you are. An heir of the promise. So God was more abundantly willing to show you the heir of the promise, the unchangeableness of his counsel. In other words, he wants to prove to you that promise, he cannot fail. You can stake your life on it. So he swore, and he could not swear by any greater but himself. So he made a promise and he took an oath. So it says, by two immutable things, God desires to prove to you the immutability of his counsel, so that you and I might come and possess what he calls a strong consolation. In other words, be greatly comforted. Sister Rowena, this is targeted towards you. In the next 2-3 weeks, just listen carefully. Your life will change. Are you listening? Eh? What's she saying? Okay. More than that. So are you listening? Okay. So God did that so as to confirm to you. He doesn't want you to get disappointed and frustrated. He doesn't want you to give up, because he knows how the adversary will buffet you with all kinds of circumstances that will want to force you into abandoning the profession of your faith. He knows. God knows the level of wickedness of Satan in opposing believers. Now, listen, church. This promise, hear how it went. It says, to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. I hope by now you understand that word, his seed, is not you and me. His seed, not seeds. His seed. And he saith not unto seeds as of many, but as of one, and to that seed, which is Christ. Am I making sense? So the promise is to Abraham and his seed. Bible says that seed is who? Christ. Is this making sense? So when God is making a promise with a reliable seed in the person of Christ, just understand how guaranteed that promise is. So God is swearing, you are going to, do you know how a church, from Abraham
to Christ. You know how many generations? From Abraham to David, 14 generations. From David to the time they went into captivity in Babylon, 14 generations. From that time to Jesus Christ, another 14 generations. All together, 42 generations. God is telling you, swearing to Abraham, in the 42nd generation, your seed will come forth. And so that you don't doubt it, and you and I, that is we, who are going to be partakers of that promise, so we don't doubt, you have to swear. And so, if you look at Genesis 28:14, the Bible says, for it to be clear to you, listen to what, how the Bible put it. He said, in thee and in thy seed shall all the families of the earth be what? Blessed. In you, Abraham, and in your seed, Jesus, shall all the families of the earth be blessed. In other words, blessedness has been defined, and the means and the channel by which we are blessed. God said it, that whoever you are, the only way to bless him is through you, Abraham, and your seed. And so, in Galatians 3:8, okay, in Galatians 3:8, yeah, it says, go ahead.
Scripture foresaw what God would justify the Gentiles by faith.
Listen to her. The scripture foresaw that God will justify the Gentiles by faith. Uh-huh.
And announced the gospel in the advance to Abraham.
Uh-huh.
All nations will be blessed through you. Okay. So those who rely on faith.
No, hold on. It says, all nations will be blessed through you. So God saw that you and I, or the scriptures saw that you and I will be justified by, listen to me please, I need you to listen. This is so powerful, so sweet. You will be justified by faith. And then he said, in you shall all nations be blessed. Talking to Abraham. Look at two things here. I want you to follow me. He said, in you shall all nations be blessed. Then he said, the scripture foresaw that the nations or the heathen or the Gentiles will be justified by faith. What's the connection between justification by faith and the blessings? I want you to do a bit of thinking here. Okay, maybe the best thing is for me to screen it. It says, the scripture foresaw that God will justify the heathen through faith. So that's the goal, that the heathen, you and I, will be justified through faith. What did he say? You and I will be justified what? Through faith. Because of that, because there was foresight, Abraham, God preached to him and said, in thee shall all nations be blessed. There is something to do with justification and blessings. Am I making sense? Okay. In Hebrews chapter 6, the promise that God gave, the promise he said to Abraham, listen, he said, in blessing, I will bless you. In multiplying, I will multiply you. That's the promise, and he added an oath. So the exact promise is, in blessing, I will bless you. In multiplying, I will multiply. In other words, he's saying that you are going to be blessed, but you're not just going to be blessed. Mercy. Leopold, you're not just going to be blessed. He says, I will also multiply you. You know what's multiplication? Who can tell me in simple words, what's multiplication? Who said increase? Thank you. So God says, I will bless you, but I will also guarantee that as you're being blessed, you'll be experiencing what? Increase. Which means you will never suffer retrogression. He says, in multiplying, I will what? Multiply. God is telling you, as I bless you, you're going to be experiencing increase, 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 increase. Everyone say increase, increase, increase. Increase is part of the covenant. Is that making sense? So you're not blessed today with a good home, and then by tomorrow, that good home diminishes. You're not blessed with good health, and by tomorrow, that good health diminishes. You're not blessed with plenty of money, and then next 2 years,
we thought you were wealthy. Now you're walking like a broke person. No, no, no. That's not part of the covenant. Are you hearing this? In blessing, I will bless you. And in multiplying, I'll multiply you. So God said, wait. All the earth will be blessed through you. Therefore, God seeing that the hidden will be justified by faith, he said, through you all nations will be blessed. Listen to me. Blessings can only happen when you are justified. If you are not justified and God is giving you a blessing, God will be violating his holiness. Then God said, this is your justification. It's not works. Don't think that, you're going to put in effort so as to qualify for his blessings. No. He said, this justification, it will be by faith. Just believe the seed. Believe the seed. Do you believe? Church, do you believe that Jesus is the seed of Abraham that was referred to? Do you believe it? Okay. Just in case you don't believe, let me give you a few scriptures. And I want you to latch onto these scriptures when you are praying for the rest part of the year. Use it as part of your ammunition, spiritual ammunition. All right. So you want to see the scriptures? Just to confirm to you what I'm saying. So in Hebrews, Galatians chapter 3, verse 22. Sharon, Galatians chapter 3, verse 22.
But the scripture has locked up everything under the control of sin, so that what was promised, being given through faith in Jesus Christ, might be given to those who believe.
Okay, so they promise. What promise? Say that again.
The scripture has locked up everything under the control of sin, so that what was promised, being given through faith in Jesus Christ, might be given to those who believe.
So the promise, which is through faith in Jesus. Tell your neighbor, the promise is through faith in Jesus. Will now be given to you if you believe. Then ask your neighbor, do you believe? Let me ask you a question. Is the condition hard? Okay. If the devil, the devil's your adversary, am I correct? Okay. So if the devil knows that, if Sister Rosie believes, she's going to be blessed. And the moment you are blessed, you are out of his jurisdiction. What do you think he's going to attack? What will be his first line of attack against Rosie? Her mind. Correct. Her mind. He will begin to manipulate her mind. The whole essence of manipulating her mind is to create doubt and unbelief. And that's the only condition for you to what? Be blessed. Now, remember that what the seed did to get you blessed, the first thing he did, he redeemed you from the curse of the law. You can't be cursed and blessed. Am I making sense? So he has extricated you from everything called curse. Now he has prepared the grounds for you to fully enjoy your blessings without any curse, acting as an encumbrance in the enjoyment of the blessings. This gospel is so sweet for me. I can't understand why anybody can ever be defeated or deflated when you have this type of sweet gospel. It's only because you don't understand. And part of your lack of understanding is part of the scheme of Satan. So it says, the scripture has concluded, let me read King James, has concluded all under sin. In other words, the scripture has judged every man as guilty. Which means there's no character, there's no conduct, there's no charisma I can bring to justify me. The only way you're going to be justified, please don't even try to bring up your character, your conduct, or your charisma. Just be, see, it's so simple. Jesus said, believe. Father, I have nothing to do. I have nothing to contribute in this thing. I'm just going to what? Believe. And who are you believing in? Who are you believing? Or what are you believing? You are believing in Christ, the seed. Now, Romans chapter 4, verse 13. Romans 4, 13. Yep. Say that again.
I was distracted, sorry.
Okay, Romans 4, 13.
It was not through the law that Abraham and his offspring received the promise that he would be heir of the world, but through the righteousness that comes by faith.
Okay. All right. So the promise is not through law. No, it's not through works.
The promise. Tell your neighbor, the promise is not through the law, but it's through the righteousness of faith. Okay, so in Galatians 3:7, it says, know ye therefore, don't worry, I'll read this. Know ye therefore that they which are of faith, the same as the children of Abraham. 9 says, know ye therefore that they which be of faith are blessed with Abraham. If you are of faith, then the same blessing that Abraham has, you have it. Sister Evelyn, are you understanding? If you are of faith, the same blessing that Abraham has, you have it. Please, there's nothing complicated about this. Pastor, there is. Pastor, you don't know what I've gone through. And yet these blessings have eluded me. Why have they eluded you? Why have they eluded you? Faith. Pastor, if you say that, that will make me angry. Because I know I have faith. I know I believe. Pastor, no, what are you talking about? What do you answer to such people? There is one thing, only one thing that voids faith. Only one thing that voids faith. The law. The law is not of faith. It's in the Bible. I mean, in the scripture. The law is, you see here, he says, Abraham received this promise through the righteousness of faith, not through the law. So when, anytime you come legalistically to receive the promise, it is voided. Let me put it this way. The promise becomes nullified in your life. And you're struggling. You're struggling. You're struggling. Pastor, I believe. Pastor, you believe. Yes, you believe that Jesus is Lord. You believe that Jesus is the Christ. You believe that Jesus is the perfect substitute. But you know what? It's in your head. Practically, you are still legalistic. And I'm going to show you how. So, what I want to show you is how you can overcome guilt, condemnation, and shame. Every time you're experiencing guilt, you know why? You know why? It's your conscience. Your conscience is telling you that something's not right. Your conscience is telling you that you haven't met expectations. And who is giving, where are you getting these expectations from? Do you know that for some of us, it's men defining the expectations in our lives? I don't know who is putting expectations in you, whether it's your family, your parents, your friends, your spouse, or society in general. And so somehow, because it doesn't look like you are meeting up with the expectations of others, you start feeling funny. And then some people, they have what they call self-condemnation. Because of what others are saying about you, what people are saying about you, you're getting condemned. Why will you allow anybody's speakings to condemn you? Even if it's at work and your boss is saying rubbish against you, then you're allowing that to have an effect on your heart. Do you know why? Because somehow you're still under some kind of law. But let me tell you, you know what? I'm just going to round this up. Then on Thursday, I will explode. There's something really deep in this and I want to say. But I'll round it up because I have something, a lot of deep things to tell you that will blow your mind. But let me just round up. Let me just give you an example of how to overcome guilt, condemnation, and shame. Guilt, listen, why am I saying this? Because guilt, condemnation, and shame is a strong, indisputable evidence that there's still some form of legalism in your life. I'm going to show it to you. Now, you know David, David described the blessedness of the man who God imputes righteousness without works. David did that. Then Apostle Paul referred to what David was saying in the New Testament and said, how many of you know that David described what exactly it is for a man to receive the gift of righteousness without works? Are you aware of this? Have you ever heard this before? You haven't. What Bible have you been reading? How can you omit some most important parts of your Bible? That's part of the devil's schemes. He blinds you to the most important things.
and you're hearing what you're hearing on TV, what you're hearing on the internet, is nothing to do with a lot of these vital things for life. People talk, and they omit the gospel. Let me show you something about read it, Romans 4. What you're about to read now will amaze you, will blow your mind. Oh, can you stop the sharing? Or is it me that will stop it?
What verse?
Oh. Romans 4, I think it's 4 or 5. No, 4. Romans 4, 4.
4, 4.
Yeah.
I've got it here. Now to him that worketh, is the reward not reckoned of grace, but of debt?
Okay, next verse.
But to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness.
Next verse.
Even as David also describeth the blessedness of the man, unto whom God imputeth righteousness without works.
Judge, wait.
Saying,
wait, hold on, Sharon. Why will somebody in the Old Testament be able to see a blessedness and the possibility that God can give you righteousness without works? This is somebody in the Old Testament. What about you now? Why can't you understand it? Read that in again, please.
Even as David also describeth the blessedness of the man unto whom God imputeth righteousness without works.
Okay. Do you want to see how David described the man who received the what?
Imputed the blessedness? Righteousness without works, saying.
Of one who received righteousness without works. Now, listen to what Sharon is about to say. He's going to describe to you what that blessedness is. Are you ready to hear? Sharon, go ahead and declare the good news. Amen. Breaking announcement Amen. From heaven.
Blessed are they whose iniquities are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord will not impute sin.
Wait. Did you hear right?
Yes.
No, that's not the nature. This is the Bible. Don't attribute any man. This is Bible. Because if you say nature, people start saying he is preaching heresy. But when you tell them that this is Bible, this is gospel, that God is saying, I will not impute your iniquity. Is it real? Is it possible? Is it possible? Do you know the implication? Do you know the word iniquity means? Including your mistakes, including your errors, including your blind spots, including your clumsiness. You know what is clumsiness? Some people can be very clumsy. Anything that is a negative against you, it will not be imputed unto you. Do you know how that is meant to affect your mindset? You know how it's meant to affect your mindset? It changes the equation completely. What did I say? It's a game changer. That is, you see, this thing you just read now, it's your most powerful tool against your adversary. You know why? Your adversary uses the instrumentality of accusation against you. What did I say? I said, if Satan wants to attack Sister Rosie, what he will attack is her mind. But Sister Rosie, if she understands the scripture and say, whatever you bring against me, all I know, Satan, sorry, I can't help you. All I know, whatever you're pointing as wrong against me, God will not impute it unto, call your name. When you answer the devil like this, let me tell you what you've done. You have completely incapacitated because he cannot proceed any further. You know what he'll say? He will tell his agents, leave this foolish one. Next. You say, skip to the next. These are not the people we're looking for. These ones are too wise. You know how this is going to affect you? Let me tell you, can you wake up in the morning and say, I don't care whatever the considerations may be. I don't care what the weather is. I don't care what the breaking news is. I don't care what social media is, what is trending in social media. All I know is that today, on the premise of the promise that was confirmed with an oath, I'm expecting the best today. Wait. How can you expect? They've told you that the economy is getting very bad. No, that's not my business. I'm not interested in that. Please, I am standing on the efficacy of the promise. Simple. I have the faith of a child. I'm not doing all those deep reasons you are doing. All I know, I have a promise. All I know is that what? I have a bank draft. You know what's bank draft? A bank check. And today I want to cash part of it. Do you know you can lift up your voice and say, you know what, today, Father, please surprise me. I want my, beef up my account. Do you know you can do that? Beef up my account. As you're saying that, beef up my account. God is beginning to create needs in certain people's lives that you have the solution to. So the devil will come and tell you, who are you?
you? What should you be asking God to be for your account? Are you a magician? What work have you done? No, I'm not interested. Satan, sorry, I don't live by works. I live by promise. I'm an heir of promise. Satan, do you know how Isaac came? Isaac came by promise. There were no works. Abraham didn't have any works to work. He was dead. Sarah had no works to work. She was dead. But you know what? Isaac came by what? Isaac came by what? At what age did Abraham give birth to Isaac? Or Sarah give birth to Isaac? She was 90. Double barren. Doubly barren. At what age did Abraham give birth to Sarah? 100. How can a 100-year-old man impregnate a woman? Is it ordinary? You think it's ordinary? It's not ordinary. So if that can happen to Abraham, then I don't need empirical evidence. I don't need natural principles to function in life. Let me tell you the truth. Let your mind, your imagination be liberated. Some of us, you have been so knocked down. People have spoken so badly about you that you don't have the boldness and courage to even lift up your head. When you're even making requests with God, it's with timidity. Many Christians today, that timidity, they say, well, I just need to be humble. They are masking their timidity with mechanical humility. Timidity is being masked with mechanical humility. Well, Pastor, I just need to be humble. I don't want too much. I'm going to share something with you on Tuesday. Why you can be very bold. You can be very bold. Let the devil go and dig out files of your past. Tell him, I don't care. I don't give a hoot about it at all. I will not be. The devil said, well, you work so hard. Look, you're too old. Years have passed. I say, I'm not interested. I am not. KFC, when did the man become a billionaire? Over 70, isn't it? In his 60s. Okay, I'll just share a short story and then we'll close. Then on Tuesday, you come, we blow it up. How many of us know the Bill Gates of UK? Mike Lynch. His worth is just slightly under 900 million pounds. That's his total assets, total worth. The man died recently. He went on a celebratory trip in his super yacht with some invited people. And they said that what happened to that super yacht is very strange. Yes, they have those tornadoes around that Sicily in Italy, but they say that they've never heard of any boat or yacht sinking. And his yacht sank within 15 minutes from when the tornado hit the yacht. They say it is strange. Now, what was happening? What was this man celebrating? This man had been fighting a case in US for almost 10 years regarding some kind of something to do with the sale of his company, autonomy. Yet they said that there were some wrong manipulation of figures when they sold that to HP. So HP was trying to pursue them. Then, see what happened. All of a sudden, he was discharged and acquitted. The courts in America threw it out. The man said that it was like a dream to him. The man called one of his friends and said, For the first time, I can sleep peaceably. In the last 10 years, anytime I wake up, I'm overwhelmed by what is facing me. I can't sleep well. 10 years, this is almost a billionaire. He can't sleep well. Me, that I can sleep like a baby. I don't have billions, but I can sleep like a baby. A billionaire cannot sleep. And then look at what happened. He said that when they discharged him, he quickly came back to UK. He has a massive estate in Sussex where he lives. So he said he was just going to retire, and then every morning he would walk his dogs, he would go to his farm and just chill with his wife and his two daughters. And so he said, let us go and celebrate. So he got his wife and his two daughters. One of his daughters had just gained admission into Oxford. The other one is also doing exceedingly well. That's his pride. And so, when this thing happened, the man, remember, he just escaped prosecution. And then he told people, this is the beginning of new life for me. And guess what? in that beginning of new life and celebration, the death, the adversary that was pursuing him, came and struck him. And he died. And his daughter, his second daughter, died. And shortly after that, the person, his partner, who both of them were fighting this prosecution together, a few days after, was almost killed in a road. He was cycling and a car struck him. That one almost died. Then recently, recently, he would park out in UK. They say, okay, we'll finish with you in America. We didn't win. He would park out. He's now suing the man's wife for £3 billion. That thing that they couldn't get in America, they're suing the wife. Then, here. The wife said, since she lost her husband and her daughter, she said, they say she has been crying. You know what the cry is? They say they call it guilt, survival guilt. So you know what it's like? So guilt is greeting this woman. Eh? You know what it is? I should have died. I should have died instead of my daughter. I couldn't. How come I couldn't save my daughter? So she's now reading with guilt. Money is not everything. Let me tell you the truth. Let me tell you why you're different. Eh? Have you heard this scripture in the Bible? It says God set Christ as a propitiation. You know what that means? As long as Christ has been set as an eternal propitiation, I am constantly receiving cleansing, forgiveness, and pardon. So that if I'm delivered from this, that thing which is pursuing me, I had victory in my new estate, it can't affect me. Because I have a propitiation. Do you understand? You know what's propitiation? A propitiation is the complete and total absolving of the wrath of God against you. Propitiation. Do you understand? Propitiation. God set Christ as a... I know where to look for propitiation. I'm not existing without propitiation. I cannot come here and boast to you and say, hey, Robert, church, I don't mess around. I'm the most serious person. I don't mess around. I obey all the rules of God. I'm pure, I'm holy. When you boast like that, I guarantee you within 24 hours, Satan will mess you up. My boast is that I'm not perfect. I acknowledge all my imperfections, but I have a propitiation who is reliable and faithful. That's it. That's the word. That's the word. She got it. Give her lunch today. Let me wear something, Tata. Metuaka, touch her, husband, touch her. Gloria Taya, I permit you. Listen to me. You are not existing like the Lynch family. You have a propitiation set for you. So you can very boldly, always walk confidently. Listen to me. Are you anticipating bad? Are you expecting judgment? Eh? Do you think that there's something wrong you've done? That they just go and rake it up and say, you know what? You did this wrong, you did that wrong. Or your grandfather did that wrong. So we have to bring a judgment upon you. Is that possible? You say that easily, but I tell the truth. Some people, that's how their mind is. Why do people have panic attack? Why are you having panic attack? Why are you afraid? Some people wake up, they feel afraid. Why are you feeling despair? Why? What's the basis of feeling despair? Because of what you are seeing before you? Can't you see a bigger picture? Let me tell you, some of you are so blinded by your circumstances that you cannot see the greatness that's waiting for you tomorrow. And that's the whole essence of the devil. He buffets you. So you are too engrossed in your circumstances. But what God wants you to do is to lift up your eyes above your circumstances and look into the horizon. You'll see glory waiting for you. Let's bow our heads. You know what I'm expecting? Radical transformation of your expectation. I'm going to go radical now. This is a mind battle. It's a what? Mind battle. It's a mind battle. Can you determine in your heart, I'm functioning and existing far below the standard that Christ secured for me? You have gone through what I call the College of Mercy. 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 You know what's mercy? Blessed is he unto whom the Lord will not impute iniquity. Is that you? Is that you? Church, is that you? If God does not impute iniquity unto you, why will he allow a man to impute a fault unto you? Am I making sense? Why will he allow? So where does the guilt come from? If God is not imputing iniquity unto you, why are you feeling guilty? Why do you sometimes feel condemned? Do you know that part of condemnation is you condemn yourself? Sometimes people condemn themselves. When they say, you know what? You're going to be first lady. No, not me. No. What? That's self-condemnation. You're meant to be prosperous and victorious. And you're still managing with your petite circumstance. That's you're allowing yourself to be condemned. Blessed is he unto whom the Lord will not impute iniquity. Who is imputing the iniquity unto you? Who's scoring you bad? Who has the right to score you bad? As far as your finances are concerned, as far as your marriage is concerned, as far as your children are concerned, as far as your career is concerned, who has the right to score you bad? Who has the right to disqualify you? Who has the right to bring out your fault and tell you, no, you didn't do right in this, therefore you cannot qualify for a good life? Who is it? You know who it is? It's your mind. What if your mind tolerates it? What else can God do? Tell yourself, let's say that together. Blessed is he. Say it, blessed is he. He that the Lord will not impute any iniquity unto. What is he imputing unto me? Righteousness. Do you believe it? Can that affect your heart? Can that affect your mind? Can that affect your thoughts? Begin to think like that. And now take up the communion element and say, thank you, Father, for the cup of the blood of Jesus and for the body of Christ. His body was broken for me. His blood was shed for me. Therefore, I have no basis to fear. Neither do I have any basis to doubt. Now, let me tell you. Listen to me. Listen to me, church. Look up to me. And say, as I partake of this broken body of Christ, I will live by believing. I'm not going to live by analysis or reasoning or rationalizing. No, those days are gone. What they say, those days are what? Do you have the ability to believe? What do you want? What do you want? Tell me one material thing you want. Huh? Do you know that many people here need houses? What's stopping us from getting house? No, seriously, what's stopping you from getting house? You live by promise. You don't live by works. A lot of people want to get a house by works. Go and get mortgage. Do you qualify for mortgage? This is the amount of mortgage we can give to you. On that basis, you now determine what kind of house you get. No, something is not right now. Something has to change. You live by promise. Is there a house for you by promise? Yes, there is. How do you get the house? By works or by faith? Okay, if the devil comes and tells you, well, what are you believing for? You don't qualify. What do you tell him? What do you tell the devil? You say, if the devil comes to you and says, you don't qualify for a big house. What you qualify is for one pinchomic house somewhere. What do you tell him? Simple. But most importantly, what do you tell the devil? I'm an heir of promise. Heirs don't earn. They don't qualify. They receive inheritance by virtue of their birthright. Am I making sense? What's his name? Harry. Prince Harry. When was his birthday? How many days ago? See all the nonsense he has been doing. Father has almost renounced it. On his birthday, he inherited, in fact, by his grandmother. My grandmother said when he's 40, he should have 8 million pounds. Doesn't matter what he has been doing. On his body, he received 8 million pounds. Some of you work all your life, you may never get 8 million pounds. I want to tell you how heirs exist. If there's anybody that has committed the greatest wrong, that boy is one of them. Yet, 3-4 days ago, 8 million pounds, according to the will written by the mother. Prince Charles cannot even stop it. That boy is entitled to that. It's his entitlement. He doesn't work for it. There's no conditionality. Why can't you think like that? You're an heir. What did I say? Just think it. You're an heir. I'm an heir. I am an heir. I don't get things by works. Can you imagine it? Can you imagine the house you want? Then go to the promise. Receive it by promise. Say, I start getting things. Start, maybe if you want to practice it, start practicing things by promise. Start practicing things by promise. And if God can do it, when I needed 500 pounds, I got it. I needed 5,000 pounds, I got it. I needed 20,000 pounds, I got it. What's stopping you from asking for 500,000 pounds? When I had headache, I spoke against it. The headache lifted. When I had fever, I spoke against it. Hey, fever lifted. Then the doctor has come to give you one heavy grammar, something, 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 something. Then that one is shaking you. Yay, I don't know what this one is. So now you instead of you to speak to you, you say, you know what, this one, I need to go and fast. I need to go and pray. I need to get the bread in. By doing that already, you know what? You are belittling yourself. The same devil that responded to your, I cast you out. If you speak with that same authority and confidence, if a principality comes, he will respect you. Body of Christ is broken for me. It was his body that bore all my sins. I will never have judgment in my life. Say it. I will never have. If you check your life, anytime bad things begin to happen to you, if you trace it, there's been some condemnation coming to your life. Let us eat. You know what the Bible says? God set him as a propitiation through faith in his blood. God set him as a propitiation through faith in his blood. As long as you have faith in the blood, you will always have propitiation. Is that making sense? So this is the cup of the blood. See, the cup of the blood shed for the remission of all our sins. Bow down your heads and say, right now, I release faith in the promise. Say, I acknowledge myself as heir of the promise. Now, this week, look at me. This week, I want you to receive things that you don't work for. Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay, so put to practice the privileges of your heirship. So is there something that you want to get from God? No. It's not that I qualify for it. It's not that I'm going to work for it. It's not that I will check my bank account to know whether I have enough money. No, just believe God for something and you want it before the end of this week to get it as an heir. Is that making sense? No, not yet. Find the money on the road. God can provide you 20 pounds. That's if God can provide you 1,000 pounds. Is he limited? Is he the God of 20 pounds? Is there another God of 1,000 pounds? Let me ask you, I'm asking. Is there another special God for 100,000 pounds? No, that's not our God. In the other religions, you have a God for fertility, you have God for prosperity, you have different gods. But our God is not like that. Our God is the God of all possibilities. In the mighty name of Jesus, I command the blessings of God upon all of you. Okay, receive it. Say, I receive the blessings as an heir of the promise. This week, I receive those blessings that are part of my privileges and my birthrights. Now, tell him exactly what you want. Some of you say you want a house. Some of you just say exactly what you want as an heir. Tell him what you want as an heir. This week. How many of you want additional streams of income? Can you receive it in Jesus' name? How many of you want to experience increased health? Just a better health. Receive it in Jesus' name. How many of you want improved relationships? Receive it in Jesus' name. How many of you are looking for spouses? You want to get spouse before the end of this year? Okay, how many of you want spouse before the end of this year? Okay, some of you that don't. So those of you wanting spouse before the end of this year, okay, I say congratulations and enjoy this week in Jesus' name.